Google, Microsoft, Intel, UNESCO, World Health Organization. There are so many elite organizations where Prabhu is invited to speak. And can you, those who attended yesterday, they should not answer this question, but can you guess how many lectures or presentations Prabhu gives in a year? Can you take a guess, wild guess? Not for the people who attended yesterday.
365.
You are very close. But Prabhu gives more than 400 classes in a year, 100 cities across 4 continents every year. So Prabhu travels, you know, all across the world to spread this presentations and Krishna consciousness. We are very, very fortunate to have Chaitanya Charan Prabhu with us. Out of his busy schedules, he is coming to Columbus every year, you know, to do this knowledge to us. So let's give a big round of applause and join me in welcoming Prabhu.
Thank you very much for coming today. So we'll begin with some prayers. You can try to repeat after me. Om.
Om.
Ajnana.
Ajnana.
Timirandhasya.
Timirandhasya.
Jnananjana.
Jnananjana.
Shalakaya.
Shalakaya.
Chakshur.
Chakshur.
Unmilitam.
Unmilitam.
Yena.
Yena.
Tasmai.
Tasmai.
Shri.
Shri.
Gurave.
Gurave.
Namaha.
Namaha.
Vancha kalpatarubhyascha.
Vancha kalpatarubhyascha.
Kripa sindhubhya eva cha.
Kripa sindhubhya eva cha. Patitanam pavanebhyo.
Vaishnavebhyo namo namaha.
Vaishnavebhyo namo namaha.
Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya.
Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya.
Prabhu Nityananda.
Prabhu Nityananda.
Shri Advaita Gadadhara.
Shri Advaita Gadadhara.
Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Rama, Rama, Hare Hare.
Rama, Rama, Hare Hare.
So how many of you are coming for the first time to a program like this? Okay. Yeah, of course, this program, everyone is coming for the first time. This program is happening for the first time, in one sense, I think. So, how many of you have, never attended any other program, any spiritual program, any Krishna conscious program before? Anyone? Okay, everybody has.
Recording in progress.
Okay. So, today we'll discuss broadly on the topic of the key to happiness. We all want happiness, but happiness is often very elusive. It just seems to be there and then it leaves us. So why does that happen? We'll discuss this based on this verse from the Bhagavad Gita and some stories from the Mahabharata, the illustrators. So let's try to recite this verse. So this is, I'll tell the meaning and then we'll try to recite it. So Krishna is saying, this is 1837 in the Bhagavad Gita, Yad Tad, that which, agre visham iva, that which in the beginning is like poison. So you can repeat, yad tad agre visham iva.
Yad tad agre visham iva.
Pariname, then the result, amrutopamam, amrut is like nectar. So that which is like poison in the beginning, will turn out to be like nectar in the air. Parinameyamrutopamam.
Parinameyamrutopamam.
That sukham, that happiness. Sattvikam proktam. Krishna says this is elevated happiness, enlightened happiness. This is a good kind of happiness. Tat sukham sattvikam proktam.
Tat sukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi. Atma means self. Buddhi is intelligence. This happiness makes us more aware of ourselves. It grants us greater self-understanding. And prasadajam. That is the result of it. That is, you could say, we get happiness, but as a byproduct, as a consequent, as a attendant result, corollary result, we also get self-understanding. Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Pariname amritopamam.
Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Pariname amritopamam.
Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
What do you like to say?
Yattat agre vishamiva.
Yattat agre vishamiva.
Pariname mritopamam.
Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yatadagre visham eva.
Yatadagre visham eva.
Pariname amrutopamam.
Pariname amrutopamam.
Tatsukam sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukam sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yatadagre visham eva.
Yatadagre visham eva. Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Pariname amritopamam.
Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam. Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yattadagre vishameva.
Yattadagre vishameva.
Pariname amritopamam.
Pariname amritopamam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Tatsukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
So, this verse broadly talks about this paradoxical nature of happiness, wherein the very things that we think will provide us happiness, they often end up providing distress. And this verse is followed by the next verse, which we'll not recite, but okay. So this depicts the nature of happiness. So that which tastes like poison in the beginning. You can see the initial layer of poison, and after that there's a long nectar. That which is like poison in the beginning, you like nectar in the end. And the next verse, Krishna says in 1838, there's another kind of happiness. Vishayendriya sanyogad yattat agre amrutopamam. Pariname vishamiva tatsukham rajasam sutam. He says there are pleasures which seem like nectar in the beginning, but they turn out to be like poison in the end. So there are many things we could put in this category. Now, if somebody smokes or drinks, initially they feel good. They feel great about it. But then after their hangover, they have diseases. They get addicted. So there might be an initial level of nectar, but afterward there's a lot of poison, a lot of trouble. On the other hand, if somebody wants to become healthy and fit, they have to regulate their diet, they have to exercise. That's not pleasant. That's often difficult. So, my friend sent me a cartoon recently. He said, this person, he says, he was used to go to a gym. He says, the gym trainer asked him, did you do your workout today? Yes. Said, yes, of course. What was the workout? He said, I walked from my fridge, from my couch to the fridge and back 80 times. He says, why 80 times? He said, because my fridge is next to my TV. And 10 times I walked to eat food, 70 times I walked to change the TV channel because my remote was not working. So, it's above average workout they were. So what happens is that we try to dodge it because it's difficult. But this is the nature of the world. Now these kind of examples are a little simple to understand. But this principle that we may chase something which will actually cause us trouble, that is a universal principle. So we'll talk about this based on two stories from the Mahabharata, and we'll focus on the character of Duryodhan as contrasted with the character of. So this is the arc of life. ARC represents the three things: achievements, relationships, and consciousness. So in general, this is the priority in which we look at things. So what we seek the most, we want achievements. I want a big house, I want to get the best employee award in my company, I want to become the wealthiest person in my community. We want achievements in life. And then okay, why do you want achievements? So that people will admire me. I also want relationships. And then, okay, consciousness. Most people don't really think much about consciousness. So it's very low down on the priority of the things that are important for us. However, if we look at life, what matters the most to us is in this life. Actually, our consciousness matters the most to us. The things around us can give us some pleasure, but the thoughts inside us can both give us far greater pleasure and far greater trouble. Even the people outside us can give us some pleasure or some trouble. But the thoughts inside us can give us far more pleasure or trouble. And if somebody recognizes this, then they focus on improving their consciousness. Then improving their relationships. And then working at achievements. But if somebody goes the other way around, they focus on achievements. Then what will happen is they are actually chasing that which is like nectar in the beginning, but will be poison in the end. So let's see how this played out in the life of Yudhishthir. So in the life of Duryodhan, as contrasted with the Pandavas, Yudhishthir and Arjuna both. Now, when you think of Duryodhan, these are characters which are villainous. So there's a particular negative attribute associated with this character. What negative attribute comes to your mind? You think about Duryodhan, yes?
Envy.
Okay, that is true. Anything else?
Greedy,
yes. So he was envious of whom?
Pandavas.
And he was greedy for what?
Kingdom.
So now if you see in terms of this hierarchy, what happened was, his consciousness was filled with envy. And because of that, he ruined his relationship with the Pandavas. And he was consumed with the craving for the achievement. I want the kingdom. That was the craving that consumed him. And this is something which can happen in anyone's life. The character of Duryodhan may have done certain villainous activities which are extraordinarily reprehensible. But this kind of craving can happen to anyone. So let's see how this happened in Duryodhan's life. Now, when Duryodhan was growing up, at that time, he was expected to be the next king. He was the prince, heir apparent, he was going to be the king. And Duryodhan, sometimes we think of him as a terribly foolish, wicked Well, that's only part of the truth. How many brothers did he have?
99.
And he actually got all of them to follow him. The first, he tried to get one sibling to follow us. It's extremely difficult. So, one of my friends gave a, you know, there is this, there's a university in India, which is very subversive. They try to portray everything from the Indian tradition negatively. So he wanted to give a talk over there. So he said, leadership lessons from Duryodhana. So we say it's a joke, it's not a joke. Actually, to get 99 brothers to follow, that's not an easy thing. We say, oh, at that time the culture was such that you always followed your elders. Well, not always. He had some amount of leadership qualities. So he was expected to become the king. And suddenly, the Pandavas came back. The Pandavas were living in the forest because their father passed away because of a tragic accident. They came. Now when they came, they were new in the kingdom. So yes, oh, it's like new kids in the family. Everybody is curious. And Duryodhan, from his childhood, had an entitlement mentality. I am the prince, I deserve everything. And suddenly he found that the attention and the affection had shifted from him to the Pandavas. The Pandavas themselves didn't do anything to cause it. What happened was that they just knew. And then actually everyone was attracted initially. But eventually, there's a difference in the behavior. Duryodhan was, even from his childhood, he was arrogant, he was entitled. The Pandavas had lived in the forest. In the forest, they had no servants to attend to their needs. They had to take care of themselves. They were lived with sages who were courteous and polite. And they were also, they also grew up in courteous and polite. So, both because of their newness and because of their gentle, refined behavior, people started getting attracted towards the Pandavas, towards Yudhishthira. So, Duryodhan just couldn't bear this. It's like, suppose we are eating a delicious feast, and to savor the feast, we close our eyes. And when we open our eyes, suddenly we are eating it, and find we touch down, and there's nothing more. Look at it. Well, the feast we were eating has been moved and given to someone else. And nothing. What happened? So Duryodhan felt like that. I deserve this. How dare it be taken away from me? But the Pandavas had no plan to take anything away from me. They were just who they were. But slowly from that point, his envy started. And he had that craving, I want the kingdom. So when somebody has this inverted mentality, like he started achievements. See, my goal in life is to get the kingdom. And then what happens is, because of that, he started putting everyone else aside. They are my enemies. Asaumaya hatha shatru. Harishya chaparana. These are my enemies, I will destroy them. And those people become my enemies, I will destroy them also. And that way, he started, he himself started sabotaging his relationships. So when he placed achievement as top priority, now he was just a team, and at that time he tried to murder Bhima. He gave him poison. He invited him for a feast, and then in the feast he said, "Oh Bhima, I cooked special food for you," and he fed him the food, and it was poisoned. So now, see, anybody can feel angry. Okay, I was the center of attention. Why is my attention being taken away like this? He could feel angry. But he could have dealt with that anger. But there's a difference between anger and hate. Can anyone say what is the difference between anger and hate?
Hate is want to destroy that person.
Okay, in hate you want to destroy that person. In anger also sometimes, isn't it? In anger, yeah. In anger people can destroy his. Yes, you are getting at the truth. Well, there is something more over there. Yes.
Anger is momentary, hate is persistent.
Anger is momentary, hate is persistent. Yeah, that's a good point. Anger is like temporary madness. It comes and goes. It's fair. Anything else?
Revenge. They want to take revenge. Hate.
So So hate wants to take revenge. Anger doesn't want. Yes, that's true. At vengefulness, hating at the other person, there's a difference in the degree. If you're going to explore, what is the difference? Anything else?
Anger is gross and hatred is subtle.
Yeah, is not?
Subtle.
Subtle, okay. I thought I didn't hear that word subtle. Maybe you spoke the word subtle, subtly.
I didn't hear it.
Okay. So, yes, anger is gross. Generally, when somebody is filled with anger, we can notice it. But if somebody is hateful, they might actually conceal the hate. So that brings us to the key difference which I wanted to focus on is, anger is hot-headed. Hate is cold-blooded. Hot-headed. So it's something similar. It's temporary. It's short-lived. But so when it is hot-headed, just a person gets almost goes mad and does something. Afterward, they regret it. They try to may fix things up, but hate is cold-blooded, it's manipulative. So a person sinisterly plans. When somebody gets angry, somebody will just hit the other person. But hate means the person will plan, how can I hit this person at a time when it will hurt the most? He'll plan, and he'll get a joy in it. So another, so to understand this difference between hot-headed and cold-blooded, is that anger usually knocks aside our intelligence. When we are angry, we just act unintelligently. But hate doesn't knock aside our intelligence. Hate enslaves our intelligence. That means a person who hates, they will use their intelligence very carefully to try to hurt the other person the most. So when Duryodhan tried to poison Bhima, was that due to anger or due to hate?
Hate.
Yes. You know, arranging a whole feast to and then planning properly. Okay, this is the food I'll give to him, and this is what I'll do, and this is how we'll be poisoned. So it's cold-blooded. Now we could just very easily say that, oh, this is a terrible character, and Duryodhan is a villain. And yes, that may be true. But actually, if we want to learn wisdom from these ancient stories, then it is helpful to try to understand not just what makes the good characters good, but also what makes the bad characters bad. Because when we may naturally identify with the good characters. I want to become like this. Well, that is good. But in that process, we may simply dehumanize or demonize the bad characters. Oh, that's such a terrible person. But those tendencies are there within us also. So if we try to understand, okay, what makes a person act like that, then by thinking of that, we can avoid fueling or fanning those tendencies within us. So we may also find in our life that we had something good going on, and then somebody else comes in our life. And when that person comes, the attention shifts to that person. And then we may feel annoyed, we feel irritated, we may feel enraged also. It can happen even ordinarily in the family. And there's one child, parents draw the attention to the first child. And the second child is born, then the attention shifts. And that's why the parents' responsibility not just to offer affection to the first child, but to ensure that there's affection between affection to the second child, but also create affection between the first and second child. So it can happen in our office, it can happen in our community. We may be doing a particular service and somebody else comes and starts doing that service better. So it may feel displaced, we may feel sidelined. So in one sense, we could say that situations can explain our emotions, but situations don't excuse our actions. Situations can explain our emotions. So Duryodhana's feeling of envy is understanding. I was having all this, suddenly it's been taken away from me. So yes, that feeling is understandable. But what he did, it can explain our emotions. It's an understandable emotion. But it doesn't excuse our actions. What he did They try to just murder him in cold blood by poisoning. It was horrendous. And that was just one of the things. It just went on and on and on. So when a person gets fixated with one particular thing, so his whole purpose in life was, I want to gain this kingdom. Now we may not be living in a world where we can become kings, but we all may have our own Kuru kingdom that we want to conquer, that we want to rule. We may have, okay, I want this kind of house, I want this kind of job, I want this kind of, this level of wealth. Now, seeking achievements is by no means a bad thing. What becomes a problem is when the priority goes wrong. When we focus on achievements at the expense of other things. And not only at the expense of other things, it's one thing to make others a lower priority. It's another to just destroy everything. So now what happened? Eventually, Duryodhan, it's such that everything that he tried to do, it backfired. But he tried to poison Bhima, but through such circumstances, poison, not only Bhima survived, but he emerged stronger. Similarly, he tried to burn the Pandavas, and they escaped, and then they aligned with Draupada's daughter, Draupadi. And they became powerful. They were no longer just orphan children in his family. They were the sons-in-law of a powerful rival king. He could no longer neglect them. They got half the kingdom. Then eventually, what happened was, he invited them for a gambling match. And in that, through a trick, he dispossessed them of everything. And then they went to the forest. They had to go. They were left penniless. The same person who had just a few months ago been enthroned as not just a king, but the emperor of the world, Yudhishthira performed the Rajasuya Yajna. Suddenly, everything was taken away from him. Now, here we see that Yudhishthir was put in a similar situation as Duryodhan was in his childhood. Although worse, in fact. See, Duryodhan, he was the heir apparent. He was the center of attention for everyone. And the Pandavas came and suddenly the attention shifted from him. Now, in one sense, Duryodhan was never the king. He was expected to become the king. So he never really had the kingdom. It is an expectation that the kingdom was going to come to him. So everything was taken away from him. Things were not really literally taken away. They were never his. But the expectation, the entitlement that they were going to come to him, that shifted. He didn't get that. And he reacted as a terrible man. Now in contrast, if you consider Yudhishthir, what happened was that he was the emperor of the world and everything was taken away from him. In that little gambling match, everything was taken away. Now, he could have responded with hate. He could have responded with envy. He could have responded with a destructive mentality. But he did not. See, in general, in this world, bad things happen to everyone. And we can talk about bad things at various levels. So Yudhishthira had achieved something. He had become the emperor of the world, and the achievement was taken away from him. In one moment, everything was taken away. So, what does he do? Not to even get a semblance of what has happened to Yudhishthir. Most of the Indians over here say, you are living in America and you build a house, you have a house, you have a career, you have a family. And one day, suddenly, visa is cancelled. And then, you say, we'll leave the country. At least when we leave the country, we can go back to our home country. We have somewhere to go to. But for Yudhishthir, he had to go out of his kingdom to the forest. He had no home country to go back to. So, horrendous situation. But he did not react to it. Why? Because he was cultivating the inside-out approach to happiness. He took that exile as an opportunity to refine his consciousness, to go deeper into wisdom, to understand what really matters in life. So, in one sense, both of them took opposite trajectories. And then, now, Yudhishthir was in the forest. He was in poverty. Duryodhan was on the throne. He was in prosperity. You could say, all of Duryodhan's dreams were fulfilled. But, was unhappy. He was dissatisfied. Why was he dissatisfied? Because envy does not provide any happiness. In fact, I saw an advertisement for a TV itself, or it was for a car actually. It said, buy this car and enjoy the envy in your neighbor's eyes. Now, it's okay, there might be some enjoyment. It's a pathetic level of enjoyment. It's okay, you make others envious. But what happens? Tomorrow they might get something better than us, and then simply they will enjoy the envy in our eyes. Isn't life meant for something better? So what happens is, envy does not provide any happiness in itself. Envy requires the other's unhappiness for our happiness. It requires the other's unhappiness. Like, say, we will buy some new clothes. Now new clothes, if you buy, it's good. We buy new clothes and nobody notices the new clothes. Nobody appreciates you. What happened? Are you people blind? So quite often they depend on others' appreciation. That's understandable, we are social creatures. But here, envy means we depend on the other person's unhappiness for our happiness. That's why, if you consider person A and person B, say A is envious of B. So envy targets the envy, but envy torments the envious. Envy targets the envy. So the reason that envy is targeted Yudhishthira, but envy torments the envious. He had no peace. So he decided, let me go to the forest. And in the forest, what he decided was that I will go and parade my prosperity. And then in contrast, when Yudhishthira will see that, oh, I am in such poverty and he is in such prosperity and he should be unhappy. And seeing his unhappiness will bring me great happiness. He went with that plan. So the prince, of course, even that plan was foiled. But the point we are making over here is that when we start thinking of achievements, we want to make us happy, then achievements in themselves never provide us happiness. It is, yeah. What happens is we always need the world to appreciate our achievements. We need the world to have something less than what we have. Only then will we be happy. So that is why Duryodhan was never happy. And at the end of it, what did he do? Finally, he decided to, after all the 12 years, 13 years happened, then the war came over. Now Krishna himself came as a peace messenger. And Krishna offered peace on the most accommodating of terms. What are Krishna's terms? It's five villages. It's interesting. All the five Pandavas were like five fingers of a hand. They were united. But there are five fingers in five different places. All five fingers are not one. They're united, but they're not one. So, they are five brothers, but they are for five villages, not one village. Each of them needed their own space. So, anyway, and what was Duryodhana's reply? I will not give you enough,
to put the needle.
A tip of a needle. Enough territory to put you on the tip of a needle. Now, when we hear this today, that's a nice dialogue. But if we understand it in context, no, it's an outrageous statement. Suppose we invite someone to come for a program and they don't want to come, so they make an excuse. Now, they are making an excuse, we know that they are making an excuse, and they know that we know that they are making an excuse. But at least there is that courtesy, that politeness to try to make an excuse. But suppose we invite someone for a program and they say, even if I die, my dead body will never come to your program. Now, this is not just a no to the request. This is like a person making some request and you punch them in the nose or kick them in the face. Hey, it's far, far worse. So Duryodhana's response was like that. Krishna was making the most accommodating proposal and say, I'm not giving you enough land to put in the tip of a needle. Now why was he thinking like this? Because he prioritized his achievement. I want to have the kingdom at all costs. And because of that, he alienated everyone. And Krishna was his well-wisher. He alienated Krishna. He, all the Bhishma and Drona fought for him. But even they had no affection for him. They fought more out of obligation than affection. He alienated everyone. So, if somebody does not focus on their consciousness, focus on achievements, what happens is, they themselves stayed unhappy. Now, achievements are not a bad thing. But thinking that achievements will bring happiness, that is the mistake. Yes, we all have abilities and we all are meant to use the abilities. And one way we can test whether we are using our God-given abilities is, what do we achieve with them? But it is not the achievement itself that brings happiness. It is the values we live by. It is the purpose that we live for. That is what brings happiness. Say, for example, we want to make money. That's necessary in life. Making money is important, but what we are making with money is even more important. What we are making with money means, what kind of relationship are we cultivating? What kind of consciousness are we cultivating? So if you contrast this with Yudhishthir, Yudhishthir was in the forest. He had lost everything. But what did Yudhishthir do? He questioned the sages. He had deep philosophical discussions. He found contentment within. And how did he find contentment? We can say, oh, he is already a saintly person. That's how he found contentment. Well, the Mahabharata is not so simple in its narration. What the Mahabharata says is that Yudhishthir asks questions about what makes life meaningful. What is the meaning and the purpose of life? And through those questions, gradually, he started coming to peace with what had happened. Now for Yudhishthir, he could have hated Duryodhana. He didn't do that. Another thing he could have hated himself. I made such a terrible mistake. I had everything and I gambled and I lost everything. Now, self-hatred. When we make mistakes, if we hate ourselves, that is also toxic. Hating others is toxic, but hating ourselves is also toxic. Why is it toxic? Because if we hate ourselves, then it is we who are constantly beating ourselves down mentally. And ultimately, if we are to love God, that means we have to love all the parts of God. And among all the parts of God, we ourselves are also part of God. And in fact, we are the part of God that we are most responsible for. That we can make the most significant difference in. So if we hate ourselves, we are essentially hating a part of God. In fact, we are hating that part of God which we are meant to most care for. Most care for, not in a narcissistic sense. I am great, I am everything. Who is a narcissist? Does anyone know? Narcissist is a person who is a eye specialist. Not that eye specialist. I don't care for anyone else. There's the word narcissism comes from the Greek Roman mythology. There's one very handsome person, his name was Narcissus. And he always wanted to look at how handsome he was. So once he was passing by a river, and the river had swiftly flowing current. So he wanted to look at his own face. He went down, looked at his face, and he said, oh, my face is so handsome. The whole body went down further. And he said, hey, you're bending too much. You fall into the river. He said, no, I'm fine. And he bent further. He was so desperate to look at his own form and his own beauty that he bent so much that he fell into the river and he was swept away and he died. So it is self-obsession that leads to self-destruction. That's narcissism. We are not talking about that over here. And we say we love ourselves as a part of God. That's not narcissism. But you understand that If God has made us, then it is He still loves us. He's with us in our hearts. So we cannot hate ourselves. So Yudhishthir avoided both the extremes of hating others, hating Duryodhan, and hating himself. And why was he able to do that? Because he was focusing on his consciousness. You see, we may have hatred for some people, and we sometimes be angry, we sometimes be violent. But hatred towards oneself is much more common. In fact, what happens is, it can happen both within materialistic life and in spiritual life. In material life, we may start hating ourselves because we may feel that I couldn't achieve what this person achieved. I couldn't do what this person did. I couldn't gain this much wealth. I talked about your money. Money is important. But some people equate their net worth with their self-worth. And then what happens is, I'm not earning as much as this friend. I'm not earning as much as this particular colleague or this particular relative, this particular sibling. That can make them look down upon themselves. It can make them hate themselves. So, if you don't achieve enough, we may start hating ourselves in material life. Even in spiritual life, there are certain standards we are expected to follow. And if we can't follow them, we may start hating ourselves because of that. But both ways, that hatred is incompatible with love. And if we are hating ourselves, we cannot love God. So, inside-out approach, means focusing on consciousness, means that we purge our consciousness of all negativity, whether it's hatred towards others or hatred towards ourselves. Yudhishthir, he had the humility to admit to Draupadi and his brothers. He said that at that time when I was gambling, I was obligated to gamble. I had to obey Dhritarashtra and Vidurasa, I had to gamble. But I was not obligated to gamble so much. He said, I lost my control of it. Of course, his intention was still noble. When he lost a lot of wealth, he thought that he was not a gambling addict who just didn't care for anything else and lost everything. He was thinking that, I am the provider of this family. He didn't have a father, so he was the eldest brother. But he said that, I have lost all this wealth. How will I take care of that? I have to get it back. You see, it's one dice. If it works right, I'll give it back and then I'll stop. And he kept trying. And he lost everything. So he admitted that I got swept away by that time. I got carried away. But he was not just, he admitted that he had humility. But he did not beat himself up for that. Now later on, while he was in the forest, in the Vedic times, sages, they were multifaceted. They knew a lot of things. So there was Vishramman, was a sage. He was expert at gambling. He wouldn't gamble, but he was expert at gambling. So Yudhishthir took special gambling lessons from this sage. Why? He said, next time if I'm challenged to gamble, I will not be defeated, Vishramman. So he prepared for the future. So not just he was focusing on consciousness. He focused on consciousness. He worked on practical strategies for dealing with problems also. But the key point here is that because he did this, he was free from hatred towards others, hatred towards himself. He was peaceful. He was even contented. On the other hand, Duryodhan was never contented. So when we practice spiritual life, we may feel, at that same time, I spent to come to a program, I spent to chant some holy names. I could be working for 1 hour, I could be earning this much money. Yes, we could be doing that. That's an achievement. But what we are doing through spirituality is, spiritual practice, we are improving our consciousness. We are enriching our consciousness. And that will ensure our happiness far more than any externals. So eventually Yudhishthir also becomes a king. And he becomes a powerful king. But his happiness does not depend on his royal opulence. His happiness is already founded from within his heart. And for all of us, I'll conclude with one last point, that when we are talking about what brings happiness, So what does it mean to prioritize consciousness first, relationships later, achievements after third? It does not mean that we neglect achievements. But we recognize that externals can provide happiness only when the internals are there. And that's why we focus on that. So we improve our consciousness by connecting with the divine. We connect with Krishna. He is the source of all purity. When we connect with Krishna, the impure things, the self, the negative things, the self-destructive things within our consciousness get washed away. Just as there's a lot of dirt and garbage in some sewage, a lot of clean fresh water comes in and all the garbage gets swept away. So like that, when we open ourselves to Krishna and sound vibration centered on Krishna, Krishna's holy names, Krishna Katha, then our consciousness gets cleansed. And then with that cleansed consciousness, then we can work to build healthy relationships. And then we can work for the achievements that matter for us. And that way we can have a full and fulfilling life. The end of the Bhagavad Gita is Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna Yatra Patho Dhanundara Tatra Shri Vijayo Bhutir Dhruva Nitya Matram. Wherever there is Krishna and wherever there is Arjuna, there will be victory. So now what does this mean? In one sense we could say that Krishna is God, so he is Lakshmipati. So wherever there is Krishna, there will be victory, isn't it? So why does this verse need to mention Arjuna? Verse says wherever there is Krishna and there is Arjuna, there will be victory. But wherever there is Krishna, there will be victory. So why mention Arjuna at all? Because the point of the Gita is not just to proclaim God's position. Or wherever there is God, there will be victory, there will be prosperity. That is not the point of the Gita. The point of the Gita is not to proclaim God's position. The point of the Gita is to transform human disposition. That human disposition means let us align with God. So Arjuna is with Krishna and therefore Arjuna will be victorious. So for all of us, if we align with Krishna, then sometimes in life there will be success, sometimes there will be not so much success. But the power of devotion is that it decouples happiness from success. I'll conclude this point, that devotion decouples happiness from success. That means devotion makes our happiness independent of our success. We will get success in life, but even if we don't, devotion connects us with a reservoir of inner happiness. And that's how we can be joyful even amidst life's ups and downs. And that is the key to happiness. Not depending on externals for happiness, but connecting with the divine within and thereby finding lasting endurement, lasting fulfillment. So I'll summarize. I discussed broadly 3 points. We started with the verse that which tastes like poison in the beginning will taste like nectar in the end. And vice versa. And then I talked about this arc. So we saw the diagram. Remember, nectar in the beginning, poison in the end. And in that connection, what does nectar in the beginning mean? Achievements are titillating, they are like nectar in the beginning. But in the pursuit of achievements, if we neglect relationships, we neglect consciousness, then we get a long tail of poison in the end. And this we discussed with Duryodhana's life story. That he was crazy for the kingdom. And to achieve that kingdom, he started hating the Pandavas and then he let his consciousness become filled with envy and greed. And because of that, even when he had succeeded, he was in prosperity and Yudhishthira was in poverty, but still he was unhappy. Because envy provides no happiness in itself. Envy requires other person's unhappiness for happiness. And eventually that led to his self-destruction. In contrast, Yudhishthira, he had to go through a lot of poison. So we discussed Duryodhana's actions. Duryodhana's emotions are understandable. But his actions are inexcusable. So he let his... Yudhishthira also lost everything. He was a king and he lost everything. But Yudhishthira didn't become hateful. He didn't become angry. He tried to cultivate wisdom. He tried to improve his consciousness. And because he improved his consciousness, he could apologize to Draupadi and his brothers. And that strengthened their bond, their relationship. Although he had made a terrible mistake, that did not rupture their relationship. And eventually, when he achieved the kingdom, he did not depend on the kingdom for happiness. others, because he had the internal connection with the divine. The devotion decoupled his happiness from its dependence on success. And that is what the Gita inspires us to do. And to connect with the divine and thereby find happiness irrespective of life's ups and downs. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions or comments? Yes.
Prabhuji, when it comes to these inexcusable actions, you know, like not everybody is on the level of Yudhishthira, right? So if somebody does something and that hurts us through their actions, and we are not on the Yudhishthira's level, there we are taking it as very positive and then, you know, go inside and do, you know, improve our consciousness.
Yes.
So how to deal with those situations practically in life, that when somebody hurts or some actions are creating some inconvenience in life?
That's true. See, my point was never to say that just because somebody has hurt us, that means we should only go inside and do nothing outside. It depends on time, place, circumstance. Broadly speaking, we can say that when something terrible happens to us, or especially someone, if something terrible happens to us, something terrible is done to us by someone, we have broadly three choices: tolerate, mitigate, emigrate. So tolerate means, okay, yeah, this is a bad thing, but you know, I can live with it. I want to focus on something more important now. And the Pandavas tolerated, and Bhima was poisoned, and Bhima came back here, come to know what happened. He was enraged. Yudhishthira said, let's not talk about this. You know, right now we are just new in this family, coming in this family. We don't want to split the family apart. Let's be watchful. So I tolerated for a long time. But eventually, when a line was crossed, he tried to disrobe Draupadi. But when he rejected Krishna, when he tried to arrest Krishna, that was over. By attempting to arrest Krishna, Duryodhan sealed his deal with death. So at that time, Yudhishthira said, now tolerance can't work. Now we can't tolerate, we have to mitigate. Now why difference? Because Yudhishthira initially saw that, okay, this was an attack on me or my family. That's terrible. But when he saw that he was ready to even attack Krishna, he had no scruples left at all. If such a person were to rule the world, that person would break havoc in society. So he saw it as a duty to his citizens. He was also part of the ruling dynasty, and that I have to protect them. So he did not fight the war out of personal vendetta. He fought the war out of social duty. So there's a time to mitigate. Similarly for us, if somebody has hurt us, at a personal level you may say, I can tolerate it. It's been difficult, but I can tolerate it. But if that person has hurt not just us, but that person has hurt many people in the past, and that person may continue hurting others, then sometimes we have to take the stand, we have to mitigate. So, and sometimes we just decided, we emigrate. And you know, it's a terrible situation, I cannot resolve it, and I don't want to spend my life burning in it, so I just move away from it. When Vidura was insulted by Dhritarashtra, by Duryodhana, and Dhritarashtra remained silent. So what happened was, Vidura decided, enough is enough. But the harsh words of our enemies don't hurt us as much as the silence of our friends. So Duryodhana's harsh words didn't drive Vidura away. Yes, they were a part of the cause, but with Dhritarashtra's silence. He had stayed all that time because he had hoped that Dhritarashtra would have a change of heart. But that didn't happen. So he just emigrated. When the Pandavas, when they heard that Krishna had departed from the world, then they also emigrated. So we can choose any of these options. But before we do any of these, either we tolerate, mitigate, or emigrate, it's important for us to appreciate that this is not just this person doing something to me. This is an arrangement of Krishna for my growth. Now I grow, how will I grow? That I have to think, that I have to pray and I have to act. But it is not just something happening by random chance and I am subjected to the cruelty of someone. There is some higher purpose over here. Whether that higher purpose is served by my tolerating, by my mitigating, by my emigrating, that will vary. But we have to appreciate every situation, that it's not just the world's cruelty or people's wickedness or just arbitrary chance. No, there is a Krishna, some Krishna's purpose working through it. And Vidura saw that. He saw that Duryodhana was speaking those harsh words. That is Mahamaya, that Duryodhana's own greed and envy speaking. But he also saw that this is Yoga Maya's arrangement. But now, because he has spoken like this to me, I have a reason to go away. I don't have to fight on the side of Duryodhana. I can go away. So devotees, we see the circumstantial cause of what is happening, but we also try to see the transcendental cause. The transcendental cause is ultimately the Lord's arrangement. So what is the arrangement? What is the Lord's arrangement for me? What does the Lord want me to do in this situation? That may require prayer, that may require consultation, that may require some time. But if we don't see the arrangement of the Lord at all, then we will simply react in the modes of passion or ignorance. And we will miss the opportunity. Not only that, we will make things worse. Does that answer the question?
Yes.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Maybe this is a follow up to the previous question, but Dhritarashtra, Duryodhana knew the weakness of Yudhishthira, that he had that weakness for gambling. And he found out the weakness and he knew that he could not defeat the Pandavas in a war, because he knew he would lose. So he manipulated him into this. So Prabhu's, in our life there are circumstances and people who try to manipulate us. How do we deal with this?
Yeah, that's difficult. When people try to manipulate us, see, there is a difference between being pure or being good and being naive. We should be good, but we can't afford to be naive in the world, because we will be exploited. So if you consider, let's go to another example, is that Sita, when Sita was abducted by Ravana, what happened was, Sita, she acted with service attitude, oh, this person looks like a sage, I want to serve him. But she was good in that sense, but she also needed to be shrewd. Now I'm alone over here, as Lakshman told me, don't go out of this. And this person, he's a sage. If he's really a sage, why can't he wait for something? Okay, now I'm not blaming Sita at all over here. He's saying that we need, why is he so insistent? Now, sages are supposed to be self-controlled. He said that, if you don't give me food right now, I'm so hungry, you will be the cause of a curse befalling on your family. So why would a sage curse just because? He was saying, just wait, my husband will come back and will serve you. So she had to be a shrewd. This being good is not enough. We need to be shrewd in the world. So what does shrewd mean? It basically means that, just like, what do we mean when, if you are intelligent, we see beyond Maya. Maya is what? That which is not. So we may think that we are the body. That's what we see. Our identity goes beyond the body to the soul. That is intelligence. So intelligence means to try to see beyond what is visible to what is actual. So that intelligence is required not just at a philosophical level, but it's also required at a practical level, at a relational level. That if somebody is trying to exploit us, then, you know, okay, once we may help someone and go along, we oblige them, and if they manipulate us and we realize that, then we have to be careful. We learn from it. So yes, being shrewd is required. In fact, the philosophical vision, the spiritual, the scriptural wisdom is meant to make us sure. That doesn't mean we don't trust people. That doesn't mean we always are trying to look for some ulterior motive in people. But it is not that we are naive. Naive means just not thinking deeply, not thinking seriously, just going along with things that feels well. That will not work. So we will be exploited if we are not. Because what happens is there is weakness and there is wickedness. So weakness means that everybody can have a moment of weakness. You know, let's say we invite some guests to our house and you know, we keep some money lying on somewhere of the house and they see that and they grab it and they go. And they come to know about it and they say, oh, you know, I was in great need, I'm sorry about it, I'll return it. That's weakness. Mm-hmm. Everybody can have a moment of weakness. But wickedness is that a person deliberately looks for an opportunity. Like wickedness is like cold blooded. There are people who exploit it. Oh, I know that you keep things carelessly. So let me ingratiate myself to you, and then you lower your guard, I will strangle everything away from you. So there are people like that. So with those people, we also need to be firm. Not only we need to not be manipulated, but if somebody tries to exploit us, you know, you say. So forgiveness is good for weakness. If somebody does some mistake out of weakness, forgiveness is required. But forgiveness in the face of weakness is kindness. But forgiveness in the face of wickedness is foolishness. It's foolishness. You say terrorists are on a rampage killing people. And the terrorists run out of bullets and the police has come and the police can shoot them. Oh, I'm sorry, please forgive me. And the police lowers the gun. And the terrorist takes out a concealed gun and shoots the police. So there are people who are wicked, unfortunately, and we not only have to be on guard against them, but sometimes we cannot forgive them. We have to hold them accountable for their actions also. Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Are you raising your hand or are you scratching your head? Yes, please.
First of all, thank you so much for giving us your divine association so that we can learn a lot. So I wanted to ask a question from the perspective of, like, sometimes when we have new people in any organization, so we motivate them. Even that could be a false motivation, so that they can stand up on their feet and they can move forward. Is it also part of considered as a wrong if our motive is right?
Okay. If, let me try to re-articulate the question. Right? You're saying that sometimes we may, to encourage somebody to do something good, we may give them some false hopes, or exactly not exactly true. We may exaggerate something or something, but we are doing it for a good cause. So is that good? Or is that manipulation? Well, broadly, the Mahabharata says that how do we decide the right? How do we decide what is the right action and wrong action? There are three criteria. There is the content of the action, there is the intent of the action, and there is the consequence of the action. What we are doing, why we are doing, and what is the result of doing it. So all these three factors that we consider. So in modern ethical theory, there are three broad categories of ethical theories or ethicists. You see, those are the categorical ethicists. This is right, this is wrong. So they focus only on the content. That's all. Mm-hmm. So that's categorical ethics. Immanuel Kant, and he was a propagator of the deontology. It's one branch of it. The other is consequentialist ethics. Utilitarianism is an example of that. You know, okay, the consequence is good, that's wonderful. And the third is what is called as character ethic. Character ethics means that what is the character of the person doing it? You know, so if a person of good character is doing something questionable, then don't immediately presume that it is wrong. Focus on a specific action, focus on the character of the person. So now, no one of these theories encompasses the complete reality. Deciding what is right and wrong is difficult. But overall, you can say that what the Mahabharata says, all three are required. We look at the content of the action. Now, there are certain things which are right and certain things which are wrong. So for example, we can say that speaking truthfully is good, speaking falsely is bad. Well, yes, but is that an absolute thing? If there's a riot going on and our friend is a part of the ethnic community that's being targeted, and a friend comes out, please save me, please hide me. And we hide in our basement, and those rioters come and knock at our door. Is he here? No. Should we speak the truth at that time? No. Obviously not. Why? Because that's why ethics become so complicated is that? Because it's not just one ethic. It's not just one moral value. We need a hierarchy of moral values. Which moral value is higher, which moral value is lower? In this case, we can easily say that, okay, saving the life of someone is more important than speaking the truth. But if somebody is fixated on categorical ethics, what they will think is, speaking the truth is what is the right thing to do. So they don't consider the consequences. But here the consequences, so speaking truth is one value which is based on categorical ethics. But saving a life, that is based on consequential ethics. So what is right, what is wrong? It's difficult. Sometimes you have to look at the intent of a person. So for example, a doctor decides to perform a risky surgery for a patient. And the doctor's intent is to save the patient. But maybe during the surgery, something goes wrong, or maybe the doctor performs the surgery when they don't have sufficient equipment. They don't have the necessary technological support or the medical support, the support staff or whatever. But they feel if we wait for that, maybe this patient will die. So then the doctor does it to save the patient. But because of some complication, because of lack of technology or support, the patient dies. So now is the doctor culpable? Well, you could say the doctor did not follow the procedure. The doctor should have waited for doing the surgery before they got this. Why did they do like this? So then you could say that the person is wrong, but the intent was good. So that the character ethics comes in. So in one sense, in real life, it is not so easy to decide. But all three factors have to be considered. And in this case, if we are pushing somebody to do something which is good for them, at that time we exaggerate some things. Well, we live in a world where promotion is required. If people are doing something, things have to be, in one sense, glorified, praised, so that people are attracted to it. Now, how far the promotion can go from the reality? That is something which has to be, which to some extent it may be individually decided also. See, some people, everybody has their nature. Some people, it's like, when they like something, they will praise it as if it is the greatest. And it's just the way they are. They refuse it in their praise. Like they like something and they will glorify, this is the best in the world. And some other people, they like something also, and I have a friend who works in a company and he says that my boss is, you come up with the most brilliant idea. He says, that's not a bad idea. And he says, that's not a bad idea is we understand the highest praise that will come from this person. So some people are different, each of us is different. So some people just are effusive in praising things. So it could be that person's nature also. So it's not a bad intent, it's not ill motivated. He says well motivated, but it's also natural. But somebody who never effusively praises, who is never effusive in their praise, and suddenly that person starts praising, then it says something wrong over here, something fishy over here. So in general, we have our nature, and we'll act according to our nature. So if that's how we function, others also understand that. So I think we all need to act according to our nature, follow our heart. But that doesn't mean we neglect our judgment. We have to use our judgment skills. But eventually, after we make a judgment, or after we weigh the various factors according to our judgment, sometimes it's not a clear verdict, this is what I should do. At the time when we need to follow our heart. And that's why, if you look at the scriptures, they're often filled with ethical dilemmas. What is the right thing to do? It's not that God comes in front of the characters and says, okay, this is the right thing to do it. No, they pray, they deliberate, and then they arrive at his feet. So, I can say there's a long non-answer to your question. So, non-answer in the sense that I can't give a specific answer, but I can give a broad principle by which the decision can be made. Does that answer your question? Yes, of course. That's when we turn, when we pray, when we contemplate, that's we are connecting with the Paramatma in our hearts. It's also, of course, good to consult those whom we trust, those who are spiritually minded, because especially those who may be better connected with the Paramatma in their hearts. We connect with, we talk with them and take their inputs. That's also very helpful. Thank you. So, thank you very much for your participation.
One question from YouTube.
So,
Sumita Mataji is asking, how do we practice devotion? How do we practice devotion? Uncouples happiness and achievements. We feel naturally happy when we achieve, which serves as impetus for more things. Please advise. If okay. We see our work as service, how does this apply?
Okay, so when I say that, that devotion decouples happiness from success. But we all naturally feel happy when we achieve some things, and especially if we are seeing our work as a service to Krishna. And what achieving some things there bring us happiness. Well, when I say decouples, that I didn't at all mean that we don't seek achievements or achievements are unimportant. It's just the hierarchy that is important. So, Arjuna was an achiever. Arjuna practiced archery tirelessly and he became the best archer of his times. So, it's not that achievement itself is bad. But, sukhe dukhe samay kutva labha labho jayaji. 520 Krishna says that, na prahanishet priyam prapya, na bujet prapya cha priyam. Sthira buddhira sammuro brahmavid brahmanistita. Krishna says, what happens is, that once we become Brahmavid, become aware of the ultimate reality, Brahma, Brahmanisthita, we become connected with Krishna, the ultimate reality, then we are not elated amidst happiness, nor are we devastated amidst distress. So we are more steady. The idea is not that we don't care for the results of our work. If we are working, we don't care. You know, say now, after this program, there is prasad. Now, the cooks, they will not think, oh, you know, I am following Bhagavad Gita, I don't care for the quality of the person, I am detached. No, they want to cook the best, they can. Why? Because that's our service to Krishna. We do try to do our best. But the purpose of a devotee in trying to do the best is not just to achieve some greatness in the world. The purpose of the devotee is twofold. One is to please Krishna. It is Krishna who has given certain abilities, and by using them fully, we please Krishna. And the second is, a devotee's focus is more on contributing to the world than achieving in the world. Loka sangraham evapi sampashyan kartumarasi. Krishna says that each of us has to play our part in maintaining the order of the world. We say, the world is such a big place, what part can I play? Well, yeah, we may say, I can't play any part in the order of the world. But we can play a big part in the disorder of the world. Each of us can create a lot of trouble if we want. So, we have our roles, and everybody, Krishna says, has to play their role. So, a devotee's focus is on more on making a contribution, and that contribution leads to achievement, that's wonderful. But if it doesn't, a devotee is not dependent on that for happiness. Certainly, if our contributions are valued, our contributions are appreciated, that brings happiness. But the idea is, I have a whole talk on the principle of work is worship. But the way I summarize is that the Gita is not talking about not caring for achievements or not caring for results. But the Gita is saying that care for something more than the immediate results. And what is that? Ultimately, it's Krishna. So for us, we work so that we work well so that we please Krishna. So I'll answer one example. Suppose there is a billionaire patriarch who has a huge chain of companies across the world. And now he has an heir, he has a son for whom the whole property is meant ultimately. But the father wants to test how responsible he is. The father tells him, okay, you go in one of my shopping malls and you act as an attendant over there. You know, you show the wares to people. Now at that time, what is this person trying to do? This is a millionaire son, but he's right now acting as a salesman. Now as a salesman, he will try his best to make the sale. But some customers are very demanding, fastidious, and disagreeable. They look at the whole shop and they'll reject the whole shop and they'll go away now. And then this attendant has to fix all the things, put all the things in place. It can be very annoying. Normally when a customer comes to a shop, all the attendants want to attend because they will probably make a sale, income, they will win their record. But some customers who are known to be very disagreeable, when they come in, all the attendants go away. That's it, there's two kinds of people. Some people bring happiness wherever they go, and some people bring happiness whenever they go. So suppose this billionaire son is encountering a person of the second category. He'll try to make a sale, naturally. But if he's polite, if he's patient, he knows that this is a test from my father. My father is watching. I'll try my best to make a sale. But even if he doesn't make a sale, his father sees it. You stay patient. You didn't become rude. You didn't blow up. All of that person is unreasonable, we have to know that. You are mature enough to handle my estate. And then the father will reward that son profusely. So the point of the son is not just to make the sale. The point of the son is to please the father. So similarly for us, when we are working, we do want to do the best we can. But our purpose is not just to make an achievement in the world, make a splash in the world by doing our best. If that happens, that's wonderful. We are able to do something worthwhile for Krishna in this world. But even if that doesn't happen, our purpose is to please Krishna. So it's not that achievements are unimportant. In the hierarchy, for a devotee, making one's consciousness spiritualized, connected with Krishna, is much more important. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki
jai.
Gaur Bhaktavinda ki
jai.
Gaur Premanande.
Thank you.